Muy buenos días, tengan todos ustedes. Estamos transmitiendo en esta semana del Día Internacional de la Mujer, en conmemoración del Día Internacional de la Mujer. Nos acompaña Shannon Harris de Metoba. Good morning, Shannon. Welcome to PSA and thank you so very much for the participation in this event. I'm starting. Cedo la palabra a Shannon para la conferencia.
Perfect. Thank you so much. So I'm going to be giving this presentation in English, but I did translate all of my slides to Spanish as well. Hace muy tiempo que no hablo español, pero trataba de traducir todo. So I'm going to speak in English though. So if you guys have any questions, just let me know and we can talk throughout this as well. Today I'm going to be talking about leading diverse teams, especially coming from the perspective of a female leader. A little bit about myself first. Shannon Harris, hi. I'm really excited to be talking to you guys today. I am the Vice President of Finance and Operations at Metoba. We are a company that is based in the United States, out of a state called Arkansas, if you guys have heard of it. And we have an office in Guadalajara as well, which is how we got connected to the University of Guadalajara team here. So because of that, I've had the great privilege to work with a team that is extremely diverse, because even though Metoba is quite small, we exist in two different countries. And so we get to have a team that is extremely diverse in a lot of different ways. So today I want to talk to you guys just about kind of three things. These topics, while they are very few, they are very big topics. I mean, we could talk about each of these things for days or for hours. They're huge, huge topics to cover. The first one I want to talk about is understanding diversity. The second one is managing diversity. And the third one is coming specifically for women in leadership. So we'll go ahead and just dive into our first topic, which is understanding diversity. Diversity is a big buzzword nowadays, especially here in the United States. We are obviously a country that is growing more and more global by the day. But diversity in itself is something that a lot of people think that they fully understand, but it's a lot more complex and it deals with a lot more than just race or just gender. There is so much more to diversity. So what does diversity mean? Diversity is everything that makes an individual who they are. So you are diverse even from somebody who you guys grew up in the same town, you guys have the same heritage. While you have a lot in common, there are still things about you that are fully diverse from the other people that you may have even grown up with. And diversity has increased even more through time because of the growth of globalization. So what does that mean? Back 50 years ago, whenever we didn't have this much technology, we didn't have social media, we weren't serving global markets. Each business very much existed just in their own local space. So they had a very small market of everybody around them, and that was it. And they knew everybody by name personally, and you just served this very small area. But nowadays, that's no longer the case. People are moving all across the world. You can live wherever, you can work remotely. Companies are expanding to serve a global market. And in part of doing that, they are also working with a global workforce. So no longer does Metoba Inc., even though we are a small company, we aren't just hiring people in central Arkansas in the United States. We're able to hire people all across the United States. We're able to hire people in Europe. We're able to hire people in Mexico. And we aren't even that large of a company. So the bigger the companies are, the more that global footprint expands. But even beyond that, there's just diversity in these spaces. So diversity can range from gender, age, sexual orientation, religion, race, of course, is probably the one that people think of most often, area of origin, and even now, people with disabilities and neurodivergent people are entering into this conversation about diversity and how they can help businesses grow. Culture, of course, class diversity. So whether or not your family comes from wealth, that gives a very different life experience to people. Education diversity. So did you go to a public university or did you go to a private university? What did you study in university? And how does that affect your mindset in the workplace? And then of course, career and industry diversity. For me personally, I work for a tech company, but I am not a technologist. So I come from a background, I originally started in hospitality. So I worked in a restaurant group dealing with growing and expanding restaurants. So that brings a different perspective to me from a technology company, just because of my background and switching industries in my career. So there's no one size fits all. And all of these differences that we all have is not something that should ever be seen as a burden. It is an extreme privilege that we are able to talk about diversity because that means that we are serving a much larger marketplace to where we have to be concerned about these things. And we want to be able to connect with each person individually. That doesn't mean that we forget about the traditional employee. So every employee does matter, and it's not a matter of a one size fits all approach. It is about managing the mix of people that you have now. So you're going to have people who are, you know, white men falling between the age of 25 and 35. But you're also going to have a whole lot of other people who are entering that workforce as well. And you want to be sure that you are meeting everybody where they are and making them feel comfortable and making them feel like they can express their opinions, even though they oftentimes are going to be different. If the world was just listening to the same opinions from people with the same perspectives, that would be unbelievably boring. So we need to start seeing diversity as a privilege of something that we get to manage and we get to understand more about. And I feel like the world is oftentimes moving in that direction, but it didn't always start there. Here are some risks of not pursuing diversity as well. So here are just a couple of examples of marketing advertisements that if these teams would have had diverse people on their staff, this would have never happened. So the first one is Sony. They were launching a PlayStation Portable in the color white. It originally had only come in black. So in 2006, they ran this ad down here at the bottom. And it was supposed to announce that the PlayStation Portable was now going to come in a white color. As you can see, I don't know if the resolution is very good, but it is a white woman with white hair, dressed in all white, aggressively grabbing the face of a black woman dressed in all black. And you can see the fear in the black person's eyes as the white woman who is the aggressor is grabbing her face. That is not a good ad. It is offensive and it should have never made it past the pitch room. And it's clear that because this team did not have certain diversities, or if they did have people of color on that team, those people did not express their opinion or their opinion was not listened to. So whenever they launched this campaign, it went to the court of public opinion and there was public outrage from this particular print campaign. And they spent all of this money printing up all of these posters that they then had to immediately take down. So it cost the company a lot of money when in reality, they should have listened to the people on their team who maybe could have told them that this was a bad idea. Another one, this one's very topical because it is International Women's Day. But BIC, you can see here, they posted this photo to social media where it says, look like a girl, act like a lady, think like a man, and work like a boss. And that was supposed to be their homage to women on International Women's Day. This was supposed to highlight women and their skills and what value they bring to BIC as a company. And this was in 2015. That wasn't even that long ago. It's not like this was printed in 1980, even though it looks like it was. The fact that they are encouraging women to think like a man and implying that that is what would indicate that the woman can be successful obviously shows that it was in very poor taste and that there was clearly not a woman who looked at the social media post before they decided to post it. Of course, people did not like this one either. They got a lot of comments that were really negative and they ended up having to take down that post. BIC, of course, is also the company that they launched a set of pens, writing pens, that were for her, as if a woman's hand was too delicate to deal with a normal BIC pen. They needed it to be pink and soft in order to accommodate for our very soft hands, because the weight of a normal pen was just too much. So BIC does have a history of being a bit insensitive when it comes to women. As for this post, a woman does not need to think like a man to work like a boss. A woman should think like a woman. And that brings a whole set of values all in itself. So let's take a look back. This is from the United States, but it should be representative of as well of as what we're seeing changing in the global marketplace. So if you look on the left, you look at the graph that shows the distribution of the workforce starting in 1950, and then again in 2000 and 2020. So in 1950, 70% of the workforce in the United States was male. Through the years, it's gotten a lot closer to being what the actual population distribution is. So we have increased almost two times what our participation as females in the workforce is from 1950. So in the United States, the distribution of the population is 51% female, 49% male. So it still is a little bit skewed towards men there, but it is a lot closer to actually representing what reality looks like. So you can see that there are a lot of things that were put in place in the 1950s. In the 1950s, you know, industrialization and businesses really started to boom in America. And a lot of these corporate cultures started to get defined there, where they would look at what you want in your typical employee, what you want in your leadership. And it was all driven by men and their opinions, because they were the ones that were making up a vast majority of the workforce. And of course, this graph doesn't also represent what types of roles men versus women were filling. So back in the 1950s, it would be extremely rare that you would have a female-run company. Men were typically in leadership positions and women were typically in support roles. So they would be secretaries, office managers. They would be in marketing roles. They would take notes during meetings. They was very supportive of the men as they were in more leadership style roles. Nowadays, it has shifted, but it hasn't made enough progress. I have another slide that'll go a little bit more into that. But we are seeing progress here, which is fantastic. And we are seeing additional progress in women taking on more leadership style roles and not just support roles of those men. So we are moving in the right direction there. And then also looking at the workforce by race. Again, this is in the United States, but it represents also what we're seeing on a global scale of people are able to move anywhere in the world. With social media, with technology, you are no longer bound to growing up and living in just your hometown. So I put the 2020 population demographics of the whole United States just to kind of show what progress we have made in the workforce. Obviously, a majority of people in the United States are white, and so that is represented in our workforce as well. However, they still have an unfair advantage in their workforce participation. They still get hired more easily, they still are promoted more often, and they still are paid more than our fellow employees who are people of color. So there is still an issue. While we are seeing improvement, it is not perfect. It is going to be something that moves very, very slowly. But the good news is that teams are becoming more representative of the actual population that they are serving. So things like we just saw on those marketing campaigns become less likely to happen because there are people of color and there are women at the table, which is the first step, of course. So they can voice the opinion of, hey guys, maybe let's not run this print ad. That is a pretty bad idea. So we're making improvements, but there's still a lot that needs to change. If you look at this graph on the left, we're looking at Fortune 500 companies. So if you don't know what a Fortune 500 company is, here in the US, it's basically the 500 largest publicly traded companies. So these are the big global companies that are based in the United States. And you can see, looking back at 2000, over 95% of the CEOs of Fortune 500 companies were white men. And again, 2000 was not that long ago. That was 21 years ago. It's not like we're talking about the 1950s here, but white male CEOs made up a vast majority of the top leadership in the United States. And you see through time, that line is starting to go up a little bit. That's great. But here in 2021 now, but as of 2020, white male CEOs still made up more than 85% of the top leadership in the United States. So even though women are in the workforce and making up almost half of the workforce, they are still not held in as high of a regard when it comes to leadership of our top companies in the US, many of which these companies are global as well, which offers a whole other problem. And if you dive into that a little bit more, you can see on the second figure, female CEOs. A vast majority of those female CEOs are also white. So that means that this lack of diverse leadership is disproportionately affecting women of color. You can see we did not get our first Black female CEO for a Fortune 500 company until 2009. And even then it was one girl. That's it. There was one Black female CEO out of these 500 companies. And it's certainly not due to her competency or her colleagues' competency. It is just working against so many years of continued oppression from people of color and women in the workforce. They have that much further to go to get to this spot of leadership. So this is something that has to change, right? And while we're seeing improvement, and we don't expect improvement to happen overnight, it is something that we need to all be aware of. So that leads us to managing diversity. I'm sure many of you will soon be in a position of leadership or of influence. Whenever you join companies or whenever you grow in the company that you're working for, perhaps you're in a position of leadership right now. In order to manage diversity, the most important first step is you have to understand yourself. So we all come into the world with biases. I was born of a certain race, gender, sexual orientation, and that has helped shape my worldview. I know my brain better than I know anybody else's brain. So I have to be aware of what my biases are. One of the best ways to do this, in my opinion, Harvard University, they have a project called Project Implicit. And you take a test and it basically points out what biases you may have, specifically as it relates to race and gender. That's something that is a very eye-opening exercise that I feel like everybody should do and even do maybe once a year or so to see how you're shifting. That's step number one. If you don't understand your own biases, you're not going to be able to check yourself whenever you are managing and you have a gut reaction to what one of your employees has done. Whenever one of your employees asks for a raise, whenever one of your employees just needs something, if you don't understand your own biases, it is extremely possible that you are going to, not on purpose, but unknowingly treat that employee in an unfair way. And that burden falls on us as leaders to be sure that we are doing everything in our power to make sure that we are treating our employees with fairness. The second thing for managing diversity is you have to understand how to manage yourself. You have to understand how you like to work in the workplace and be able to communicate that to your team. Me, for example, I'm a very independent worker. I like to understand the vision of what we're trying to build. And then I like to be left to my own accord to just kind of work on those things. It's a lot different for a lot of other people. A lot of other people enjoy working very closely in teams. A lot of people like a lot of back and forth feedback. And that's okay. No one way is correct. But in order to be aware of how to work best with your employees, given their diverse backgrounds, you have to understand what works best for you and why. So one of the reasons that I like to work independently is because I am a female who, whenever I was going through my education career, I was pursuing a degree that was mostly full of men. And I'm sure that you guys have this as well with the engineering university. It is a very male-dominated field. And so whenever we would get assigned to teams, I would always be the only female in the room. And so if I was working very closely with the team, they inevitably would want to give me a support role, something like take notes or something like that. And I didn't like that. I didn't want to just take notes. I wanted to own the whole project. And so I would end up taking on pretty much all of the tasks by myself and do the work by myself rather than actually say something to the team of, hey, I think that my capabilities are a lot more than taking notes. So that's the reason that I manage the way and work the way that I do, or one of the many reasons that I work the way that I do. So if you don't have that self-awareness, it's going to be really difficult for you to empathize with your employees and understand not only how they work, but also why they work that way. What experiences in their lives have shaped them to work and be comfortable working the way that they do? And not to say that that's to change them or anything. Again, as a manager, you should try and meet your employees where they are and find the best ways to accommodate their work styles that make them most comfortable. The third thing on this list is learning how to be vulnerable. As a leader, I often ask my employees to give me feedback. If they come to me with an idea, And I say, that's good, but let's think about it this way. I'm very quick to say, you know, I could be totally wrong. You have more context about this than I do. Let me know if you like that idea. What do you think about that idea? And I want them to be able to speak freely with me. They're not going to offend me, even though they may be worried that they are. They're not going to offend me. So as a leader, you have to show your employees that it's okay to be vulnerable. It's okay to ask for help. It's okay to ask for clarification. And the only way to really make your employees understand that is by showing vulnerability yourself. You know, leaders don't have all the answers. They're not always right. And that's totally okay. That's why we have teams of people. We hire people who are extremely smart and driven and have great ideas that are different from our own. The last thing on this list is audit your own inner circle. This is a really important one, and it's also one that is the most difficult. Basically, you become who you spend the most time with. So if your personal friend group is just a whole bunch of people who look exactly the same and were raised the exact same way, first of all, that's very boring. Second of all, you are obviously not utilizing all of the tools that technology has given us to expand our friend groups beyond even who is located near us. And you also may be falling into an echo chamber. So take a look at your inner circle and ask yourself, you know, do I have people who may be coming from different life experiences than me? Do I have people who disagree with me in my friend group? And if I don't, take a hard look at why that is and what you can do to expand your friend group. It may be uncomfortable at first if you're used to interacting with the same types of people all the time. But once you step out of your comfort zone and you invite somebody who is very different from you into your inner circle, you are going to be so much better because of that. A lot of people, especially here in the US, during the election season, there was a lot of talk about boy talk or locker room talk that was really offensive stuff. And it was just very clear the people who were talking about this locker room talk clearly did not have a female in their lives who was giving them feedback as to what was appropriate and what wasn't. And it's a very simple thing. It's not going to hurt your style to expand your friend group. If anything, you are going to walk away a much cooler person, a lot more cultured person, and somebody who is able to relate to more people than just people who look like you. All right. Managing teams. So once you have a good understanding of yourself and you're able to self-manage, then you, of course, have to change that into managing your team. So treating people equally does not mean treating them the same. This is one of the biggest things about diversity. You move from diversity to inclusion to equity. Everybody's heard of the golden rule. That's treat people the way you want to be treated. We have now expanded that into the platinum rule. Treat people the way that they want to be treated. Just because I like to work independently, just because I like to be treated a certain way, does not mean that that is the correct way for any of my employees. And it is not fair of me to expect that. So how do you do that? How do you figure out how to treat people then? There's a very, very simple way, and it's just ask. Just ask them, you know, the worst they can say is that they don't have a good answer for it. But get into the habit of asking, is it okay if? And by doing that again and showing that vulnerability that you don't know the answer to this and you're wanting their input, allows employees to get more comfortable with giving you that feedback on what they are the most comfortable with. So in order to treat people the way that they want to be treated, you have to ask them how they want to be treated. And then you actually have to listen and take that to heart. That's one of the most important things. It doesn't stop with just asking. you have to really absorb what they're saying and change your ways to accommodate the way that they need to be treated. The third thing here is to do your own research. There is a lot of resources out there about different communication styles, religious beliefs and holidays, cultural differences and sensitivities. For example, at my last job, we always would post on our Slack channel, happy birthday to anybody who had a birthday. However, one of our employees, their religion, he was a Jehovah's Witness. They did not believe in celebrating birthdays and so, or any holidays, really. So we had to be very sensitive to that because he did not want a birthday shout out on his birthday. He did not want that attention. It went against his religious beliefs. And that's totally okay. But that was a question that we were not asking to our employees of, hey, are you comfortable with us sharing your birthday with everybody in the company? And it was a big wake up call for us. From that point on, we did not just give blank shout outs to people. We made sure it was okay with them before we did give them a public shout out. Another thing that we've run into is we would go to lunch every once in a while as a team. And there are certain religious holidays and certain religions where people fast during the day. And so us being completely unaware of that would ask people of these religions to come out to lunch with us during a time that they were fasting. And so if they did go on the group activity, then they would sit there and not eat. And of course, get a whole bunch of questions around that. Or they would deny going on the group activity when the reality is we should have just been aware that it was Ramadan or whatever it was. And just not gone to lunch that time, maybe go bowling instead, something that would have made them more comfortable. So of course you can ask, but you don't want to put all of the burden on the employee to figure that out. You as a leader also need to take the accountability of doing your own research and making sure that you're being sensitive to just some of these basic things that are core to what people believe. The last one is using your power to advocate for your employees. So once you take the time to really understand your employees, it's your responsibility as a manager to help them develop. Their success is ultimately your success. The more that they're able to achieve, the more that they're able to accomplish, the better it is not only for the company, but also for you and your team. It's a great reflection on a leader. So always be sure that you're advocating for their success and that you're advocating for them to be understood in the larger organization. So if you have people who come from different backgrounds than maybe what the leadership in your organization is, make sure that you're doing your part in those conversations to say, hey, I think you've got this wrong about that employee. Here is why they maybe said that thing or did this project in this particular way. And here's why that's okay. So don't be afraid to speak up to power and make sure that you're still advocating for your employees. Okay, the last thing I wanted to talk about was just a little bit women in leadership. So in the spirit of today, I want to talk a little bit more about that. This is a huge topic. Again, we could speak for days about this. I'm going to try and keep it pretty short, although I do tend to get a little bit on a soapbox about this. So I wanted to pull this chart back up and just kind of dive in a little bit more. To me, this chart clearly shows that there's a problem. Women have been participating in the workforce since the beginning of time, at a lower rate, of course, but we have been active members of the workforce for some time now. However, the shift to giving us positions of power has been much slower because all of these workplace cultures were defined and solidified whenever it was just white men who were in leadership. And people who are in that position of power historically hesitate to give that up. So it is perpetuated through time and it's not something that's going to shift overnight. So I'm going to talk about a few things that that affect women making leadership positions. The first thing is the glass ceiling. So that's the invisible barrier that keeps women from achieving leadership positions. And nobody is quite sure exactly why that is. A lot of it has to do with this unconscious bias. A lot of it has to do with likability and how women are perceived by their fellow coworkers whenever they are pursuing positions of leadership. A lot of it has to do with family planning. People get nervous because women may end up at some point taking maternity leave, and it holds them back, and it's not fair because men too have children. And so it does not stop a woman from being in a leadership position. But there is a multitude of things that contribute to this glass ceiling, but you see that a lot. Women get to a certain position, a mid-level position within a company, and then they stagnate. And it becomes very difficult for them to actually achieve that next step of leadership, no matter what they do as a person. The other thing that we have here is the gender wage gap. So in the United States, women earn 82 cents for each $1 that a man earns. I put mean there, a little bit of a Freudian slip, I guess. But in an equal position, a man will earn $1 while a woman will just earn 82 cents. And then if we dive a little bit deeper into that as well, Black and Hispanic women earn just 58 cents for every $1 that a man earns in a similar position. That is almost half. So this is a huge issue, and it could be for a multitude of reasons. Men typically ask for more money whenever they first join a company or in their entry-level position, while women typically have some more issues just with asking for what they deserve and really valuing themselves at a high market rate. And so then, even if you get a 10% raise, just like your male colleague, he started here and you started here. So as you're going up, he's still gaining more and more than you because he asked for more at the beginning. Of course, there's also just the perception of managers of women's competency in the workplace. So they don't get as many promotions. They don't get as many raises because the way that we are evaluated as females, it does materially differ from how men are evaluated. So this is a huge issue. And then, of course, family demands. Society has, of course, put a lot of pressure on women as it relates to the family. And a lot of women feel that at some point in their career, they have the pressure to choose between their family and their career. And neither choice is incorrect, but it shouldn't be a choice. You can have both. But no matter what they do, they're going to be judged either way. So let's say that you are a mother and you're also a career woman. So maybe you missed a recital because you were out of town, a dance recital for one of your children. There is going to be judgment coming your way as the mother that would not exist if the husband were to miss the same recital for being out of town. And then on the other side of the house, let's say you have a really budding career and you have a baby and you want to take 6 months maternity leave. Awesome. That's great. Kids grow up so fast. You know, taking those 6 months is totally something that you can choose to do. But then whenever you come back for your job or you enter the workforce again, oftentimes women get judged by their hiring, the hiring manager at these companies for taking that additional time and having that gap in their resume. So it's something that is extremely unfortunate. And these are big, big problems. So the question here is why? Why is this happening? And ultimately it comes down to eons and eons of women being in specific roles and having these gender roles and men having these other roles. So society values traits in women much differently than they value traits in men. Women are typically expected to be kind. We're expected to be nurturing, accommodating, and empathetic. And these are all awesome. These are great traits to have, but they are not exclusive to women. Everybody should be kind. Everybody should be empathetic. But these are the traits that are most closely associated with females and not typically associated with men. For men, they're expected to be strong and decisive. They're competent and very stoic. Those are also great traits to have. That's awesome. But those are things that women can be at an equal rate as men. So that brings us to the competence, likability dilemma. This is basically whenever women are compared to men, they are less likely to be seen as both competent and likable. So it's one or the other. I've seen this a lot in my career. I am a very career-driven person. I focus a lot on my professional growth. I focus a lot on my work. And because of that, I have been seen as not being very likable. I have been seen as aggressive. I have been seen as competitive. And while those things are sometimes, if I was a male, they would be seen as positive things, when it's in relation to me, because I'm a female, they are framed in a negative way. And that's a problem. So I want to bring attention to a case study that happened. So it's, I believe that this was at Harvard. A professor handed out a case study to his class. It was written by a woman named Heidi Rosen. And this professor decided to take the case study, and for half of the class, he changed the author's name to Howard. So he hands this out, they get in groups, they're all talking about the case study in their respective groups. And the students were asked to rate the author of the case study on competency and likability. So both the female and male students rated the authors as equally competent. That makes sense, right? Because it was the exact same case study. No words were changed other than Heidi to Howard. However, both female and male students found that Heidi was unlikable, and they said that they would not work for Heidi, nor would they hire Heidi, because she just does not seem very pleasant. However, the half that had Howard as the author said that they would gladly hire him. They would gladly work for him. Seems like a nice guy. The issue is that there was no words that were changed in this case study, but because Heidi was dealing with topics and using stern language, as you do whenever you're delivering facts, she was seen as extremely unlikable. So that's a huge issue for us as women, right? Because of course, we as human beings in this world want to be liked. You know, I think I'm a nice enough person, but if you ask some of my colleagues, I'm sure that they would have a different opinion about me. And that sucks. I mean, we all want to have those close relationships, and especially being females, we are driven a lot by our connection with other people. And we don't want to make people uncomfortable with us. So we tend to dim our own light in order to accommodate, to make other people feel more comfortable in our presence, instead of just focusing on doing the correct thing without regards to how it's going to be perceived. So what's the solution here? Unfortunately, there's not really a good one, which is not, of course, how I like to end this presentation. But of course, if I had a solution, then I would be off giving talks about how women in the workforce can fix all of their problems that have been coming down for the past hundreds of years. But that doesn't mean that we're powerless in this situation. In fact, quite the opposite. Society is shifting, but it just happens so slowly. So as much as I would like everybody to wake up tomorrow morning and say, we've been viewing women unfairly this whole time, it's not gonna happen. It's gonna happen one by one. And those people are going to educate other people, and then eventually society will catch up with the reality. But we can only control what we do. I put this quote down here from Rumi. It says, yesterday I was clever, so I wanted to change the world. Today I am wise, and so I'm changing myself. So that's all we can do. In our small actions throughout the day, we can audit ourselves and how we are behaving in the workplace, as well as how we are treating others in the workplace, in hopes to improve this problem through time. So the first thing we can do is educate ourselves, become aware, have these conversations that you guys are having today of what are the issues that women are facing in society and why is this happening? That's step number one, be aware, be self-aware. The second one, advocate for each other and find mentors. Men are not the only problem whenever it comes to putting women in leadership positions. Many studies have found that women view other female colleagues as competitors to them. They get threatened and they will also actively hold other women down. That has to stop. Just because you as a female leader struggled a whole bunch to get to your position does not mean that you should ever try and put that on another female. So it's something that we have to check in ourselves as well every day. We have to advocate for each other. If you're in a meeting and you hear a woman being unfairly judged, step up and say something. Say, hey, that's not cool. I think that she has a very valid point. Or, hey, let's hear what Ashley has to say about this. I think she's got some really good knowledge on it. And find mentors, find women who have done things that you aspire to do in the past and ask them to be your mentor. That's a formal conversation that it may feel uncomfortable for you to have, but I promise that the people who you are asking are extremely flattered by that, and they would like nothing more than to help you succeed as well. The third thing, point out disparity. So this relates to advocating, but whenever you are having conversations with other people in your company and you hear a woman being unfairly judged, whether she's in the room or not, say, hey, I don't think that that's fair. And be able to use your power to point out some of the disparity issues. If you're in a role that looks at compensation and you see that there's a clear disparity in compensation between men and women, point that out to your leadership, because that is something that affects the company overall and something that everybody should be aware of. A little fun thing that I like to do whenever it relates to pointing out disparity, there's this website you can go to whenever you're in a meeting, and it's called isamantalking.com. And it's a very simple website, and it's just a button in the middle, and you press it every time a man is talking, and then press it again whenever a female starts talking. It is eye-opening how much of the meeting time is monopolized by men speaking. Even though if you were to ask them, men typically have the perception that women talk more. That's not true. It's just that it is okay for men to make their point more than it is okay subconsciously for women to make that point in the meeting. So they are interrupted 3 times more than men, women are, while men still occupy at least 2x the space. So if you guys are ever in a meeting where you want to do that and then share the results with everybody in the meeting afterwards, that's kind of a fun tongue-in-cheek way to point out some disparity. The fourth one is educating others. So have these conversations with other people. Whenever your friends are talking about, oh, I just feel like I want to ask for this raise at work, but it's not the right time. Educate them. Educate them on what some of the issues are and why they need to also advocate for themselves, why they need to find these mentors to help them inside and outside of their organization. The fifth thing is demand a seat at the table. Like we talked about earlier, the company is always better off the more diverse the voices are that are making these decisions. So demand a seat at the table, and not as a note taker, not as a support role, as somebody who's contributing to the conversation. I remember I was hosting a meeting one time for another company that was coming in, and it was for this restaurant franchise, and they were looking to open a restaurant franchise. And we had a big conference table. There were about 8 chairs that were around the table at the time. And we had five people from our team sitting at the table, and they had five people from their team. So all of the men on, there were two females, three males from their team, and all of the men came and grabbed their seat at the table. And the women found chairs, but they sat away from the table. And so this demanding a seat at the table is not just figurative. It is literal. You know, I asked them to come into the fold and actually sit at the table with us because they were of equal value to the conversation as everybody else. But they took it upon themselves to immediately be the ones who would sit away from the conversation. We can't do that anymore. Don't worry about being accommodating. Say, hey, scooch over. I deserve my seat here. And that leads to the sixth thing. Ask for what you deserve. So we talked about the pay gap. A lot of times women ask for less than what their male colleagues will ask for the same position. Do your research before you show up. You know, there's a lot of different resources out there that show you what the market value is for these roles. Do your research and understand your value, that you are contributing to the overall success of this company, that you come with a fantastic resume and that you deserve to be there. And do not hesitate to ask for more. Do not hesitate to walk away if they're not willing to give you what you think that you deserve. All of that is okay, but you have to ask, because it's very rare that you will just be gifted the things that you really deserve. It's something that you have to take accountability for. And the seventh thing is lean in, no matter the resistance. So all of this stuff I just listed, like I said, it's not going to be a change overnight. It's something that everybody has to lean into every day, and it's exhausting. And I wish that it was different. I wish that everything would just change immediately, but it's not going to. So it's something that we all have to collectively lean in together and fight for, because it is really what we deserve and what our companies deserve, because our opinions bring so much value, and they should be heard. Okay. That's it for me. Are there any questions or anything? No.
The student have two questions. What activity was made it difficult for you at work?
Yeah, there's been a lot. The question was, what activity was not equal for me at work? Yes. Okay. There's been a lot of them. I mean, so many that I can't even count. There's been situations where, you know, I'm sitting in a meeting and I have an idea and I present that idea and everybody just kind of brushes past it. And then my colleague over here, you know, let's call him Dave, he presents the same idea and everybody's, oh, Dave, that's such a great idea. Why didn't I think of that? And I'm like, well, Dave didn't think of it either. I did. And so that's something that, you know, it's not fair and it happens every single day. But it's something that I've gotten into the habit of just saying, like, hey guys, I said that like 2 minutes ago and nobody listened to me. So I think that getting comfortable with making everybody else somewhat uncomfortable in their biases helps kind of bridge that inequality.
Okay, thank you. And so what messages COVID give the to student of the say? What messages?
Yeah, my number one message is just to always advocate for each other. You guys are in a position where you have fellow classmates who are going to go through the same struggles as you're going through. And the best thing you can do is support each other and advocate for each other, because you don't want to be in this fight alone. And you're not in this fight alone, even if it does feel like it. Be there to support each other, help each other out, be bold and lean on each other for that support. That's my biggest message to y'all. Okay, any other questions? All right, awesome.
I do have a question.
Yeah.
What do you think we as men can do for the example that you did, that when Dave said something and you said, like, you know, I did say this a minute ago. So what do you think we men have to do? What I try to do is recognize and say, this is what she said, and let's remember that. But I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah, no, I think that's exactly it. And I don't want to paint this in a way where men are doing all of this on purpose. They're absolutely not. They just oftentimes don't think about it because it's not something that affects them personally. So why would they think about it? So I think the most important thing that men can do, one, you're already doing amazing because you're here, you're having this conversation. But just realizing your own biases at times, and then also helping soften that message to your male colleagues. So instead of having the woman call out like, hey, I'm being treated unfairly, that message is much better received when it comes from a fellow man. So even if you just are pulling somebody aside after a meeting and saying, hey, you said this thing during that meeting today that, you know, I know nobody said anything about it, but I think it made a lot of the people uncomfortable in the room, including myself. You know, please don't say that next time. Being the messenger on behalf of your female colleagues is something that, while it's difficult, is so important to actually implementing change. Once men see that it is okay for them to advocate on behalf of the fellow females that are in the room, then it just spreads like wildfire and people become a lot more aware of the issue. So I would say that's probably the most important thing that males can do in this situation as well.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna stop sharing. Thank you guys so much for having me today. I had a blast talking to you guys about this. I can also share my contact information if anybody just wants to reach out to me with any questions. It is shannon.harris@matova.com. And I'm happy to talk to any of you guys about any of the stuff that you're interested in, or if you just want to chat and get connected.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for your support at USA. And thank you very much for your participation. I'm sorry. My English is good.
No, you're doing great.
She is Hannah Harry, Vice President of Finance and Operation. Yeah, okay. Is Matova?
Yep.
Okay. Thank you very much. Muchísimas gracias. Muchísimas gracias a todos. Ahora la siguiente conferencia está a cargo de Miriam Sánchez, también de Metova, Miriam Leticia Sánchez Orozco, de Metova, y ella nos va a hablar sobre los derechos laborales de la mujer. Pues todos tuyos los chicos, recuerden que estamos transmitiendo en el canal de CUSEI y estamos en redes sociales en las diferentes páginas de unidad de vinculación de el Centro Universitario de Ciencias Exactas e Ingenierías también, y estamos por Zoom. Hola, cedo la palabra a Miriam. Gracias. Muchísimas gracias por la participación.
Gracias, muchas gracias. Bueno, pues yo soy Miriam Sánchez, trabajo también en Metova con Shannon. Y bueno, yo les voy a hablar un poquito de los derechos laborales de las mujeres en México. Bueno, para hablar de los derechos laborales de las mujeres en México, es importante también de hablar de los derechos humanos, ¿no? De las mujeres como tal. Aquí en México tenemos, además de derechos humanos, contamos con el Instituto Nacional de las Mujeres, los cuales defienden diversos derechos de las mujeres. Entre ellos, bueno, tenemos la igualdad del género, el derecho a la educación, a la salud, a una vida sin violencia, al trabajo, al desarrollo, a un derecho al medio ambiente sano y un derecho a la información. Esto es en general. El día de hoy nos vamos a enfocar a platicar un poquito del derecho laboral, como tal, el derecho al trabajo, ¿no? ¿Cuáles son los derechos laborales de las mujeres? La Secretaría del Trabajo habla que los derechos de las mujeres en el artículo 164 de esta, que no pueden ser inferiores a los, a los derechos de la ley, ¿no? ¿A qué se refiere esto? Bueno, vamos a platicar un poquito más adelante de esto. Específicamente, bueno, las mujeres tienen derecho a una jornada laboral sin explotación. ¿A qué se refiere una jornada laboral sin explotación? Es una jornada laboral tal cual como viene marcada en la Ley Federal del Trabajo. Una jornada laboral ya sea de 8 horas, si es un turno diurno que abarque parte de la mañana, parte de la tarde, un turno de 7 horas y media para un turno mixto y 7 para el horario nocturno. El horario nocturno abarca más o menos a partir de las 8 o 9 de la noche hasta, bueno, la mañana, ¿no? Y que también no hagan horas extras adicionales a las que marca la ley, que estos son 3 horas a la semana y no más de 3 veces a la semana. Bueno, aquí también hablamos que es muy importante que toda mujer debe recibir un salario justo, un aguinaldo anual, vacaciones y capacitación. Habla la Ley Federal del Trabajo que el salario justo, bueno, es un salario superior a un salario que se está ofreciendo en conforme al mercado. Un aguinaldo anual, conforme viene marcado por la ley, que son 15 días de vacaciones al año, vacaciones, 6 días de vacaciones el primer año y se van aumentando a partir del segundo año, con su prima vacacional del 25%, y ofrecer también una capacitación. Obviamente las mujeres también tienen derecho a recibir descansos en su jornada laboral. Usualmente la ley dice que es un día de descanso con el sueldo íntegro. Eso significa que si hay una jornada laboral de un lunes a un sábado, el domingo tendría que ser un día pagado. Dependiendo mucho de la actividad, hay empleos en los cuales se rotan turnos, entonces el día de descanso se puede ir moviendo. Sí, obviamente, pues si se trabaja un domingo, bueno, hay un aumento también de pago, si se trabaja en día feriado, ya sea un doble o un triple pago por ese día. Es importante también mencionar que todas las mujeres tienen derecho a la salud, ya lo hablamos anteriormente. ¿Qué es esto? Al nosotros estar trabajando para una empresa, obviamente tenemos que tener derecho a un seguro social, ya sea seguro social de parte del seguro del IMSS o sea del ISSSTE, según corresponda, ¿no? Tenemos derecho también a una atención médica oportuna, medicamentos y servicio hospitalario para la mujer, para sus padres y para sus hijos. El seguro social es posible que tú cubras a tus familiares sin ningún costo, adicionalmente de a tus hijos. Otra de los derechos que tenemos como mujer en México es al acceder a las guarderías. Las guarderías son un servicio gratuito que otorga también parte del seguro social y se abarca desde los 3 meses, desde los 0 años, que son usualmente los 45 días, hasta los 4 años, que se abarcaría primero de kinder en estas guarderías y no tienen ningún costo. Están accesibles para cualquier mujer. También, obviamente, pues el gozar con estas vacaciones pagadas, ¿no? Ya hablábamos que el primer año solamente de trabajo son 6 días por ley y van aumentando pues hasta llegar a 12 días. La mujer también tiene derecho a una pensión, una jubilación, ya sea pues por invalidez, retiro, servicio o cesantía. Todo esto está incluido cuando tú vas y trabajas en una empresa y obviamente se hace el pago de tus obligaciones, ¿no? Del seguro social, en las cuales te incluye los pagos patronales de esta parte. Hablando específicamente de un derecho laboral de las mujeres en el embarazo, habla muy claro la Ley Federal del Trabajo, que es el artículo número 170. Aquí habla específicamente que las mujeres en periodos de trabajo no pueden realizar esfuerzos considerables que pongan en riesgo su salud o la de su bebé. Esto significa que si tú, mujer, estás trabajando en una fábrica o con actividades que ejerzan cierto esfuerzo de tu salud, peso o simplemente sean horarios nocturnos, no es posible que los trabajes de esa manera. Tu empleador está obligado a moverte a ti a un horario que sea en la parte de la mañana y parte de la tarde, y adicionalmente evitar toda esta clase de trabajo. No usualmente los mueven a trabajos administrativos. Aquí también es súper importante hablar de la incapacidad. Se dan 84 días de incapacidad, usualmente son 6 semanas anteriores, 6 posteriores al parto. Actualmente el Seguro Social acaba de reformar su ley, tiene más o menos 4 o 5 años que se reformó, en la cual anteriormente, bueno, te daban los días completos, ¿no? Ibas al seguro, te daban tu hoja verde y te los daban completos a partir del día que ibas. Ahora tú los puedes adelantar, los puedes retrasar, depende a tu conveniencia, ¿no? Y a tu salud y al certificado médico que tú puedas estar, pues, entregando. También es súper importante hablar que todas las empresas están obligadas a darte un periodo de lactancia de máximo 6 meses. ¿Qué significa esto? Pues que tú tienes 1 hora al día para poder estar dividida en media hora y media hora para poder dedicar a la lactancia, ¿no? Si estás en tu horario de trabajo y en tu trabajo, bueno, para poder recolectar la leche y poderla estar guardando, y o si no, poder salir 1 hora antes de tu trabajo y dedicarla, pues, a la lactancia, ¿no? También, obviamente, en las situaciones de adopción, también se disfrutan de este descanso de 6 semanas. Obviamente, también hablando de despidos, está prohibido si es por razón de embarazo, ¿no? La Ley Federal del Trabajo ampara totalmente esta parte y también derechos humanos. Y hablando de lo que está prohibido explícitamente en los centros de trabajo, bueno, pues es el acoso o el hostigamiento sexual en los trabajos. Para eso, no nada más la Ley Federal del Trabajo lo defiende, sino también derechos humanos. También lo que está prohibido es solicitar certificados de no embarazo para que tú puedas ingresar a trabajar. Hay empresas en las cuales no te avisan como tal oficialmente que te van a hacer este certificado o que te van a hacer una exploración física, pero lo hacen y es ilegal. Entonces, es importante, pues, que tengan cuidado en esta parte, porque uno no tendrían por qué negarte un trabajo si estás en una condición de trabajo. Bueno, vamos a hablar aquí de reclutamiento en México, cómo funciona, para que podamos entender qué está sucediendo en México, por qué no se respetan los derechos laborales de las mujeres y por qué muchas veces no somos conscientes de lo que estamos viendo, ¿no? Aquí yo les pongo ejemplos de ofertas laborales de diferentes lugares. Me gustaría poderles platicar más a fondo de lo que significan las palabras que aquí vienen. Veamos el primero. Dice, recepcionista con buena presentación, viene un salario, viene un poquito de la empresa, lo que se ofrece, ¿no? Aquí vemos, como dice, antes de impuestos, prestaciones, etcétera, que bueno, aquí sí pagan el salario ante el Seguro Social, ¿no? Porque ofrecen prestaciones y todo. El problema aquí viene de un tipo de rechazo que se está haciendo desde la oferta laboral. ¿Por qué? Porque se está discriminando. Habla específicamente de recepcionista, buena presentación. Una recepcionista que te hablan con buena presentación es alguien que evidentemente da a entender que tiene que tener, que tiene que ser guapa, tiene que ser, tiene que contar, pues, con, o con buen cuerpo, o que tiene que venir de ciertos estándares, ¿no? Para que pueda ser aceptada en este empleo. De aquí de entrada ya es un empleo que está con sesgos, ¿no? Está aquí rechazando si tú no cuentas con esto, ¿no? Entonces, es un empleo que no debería de ser así. Supone que las ofertas laborales deben de ser neutras, deben de ser en general y no tendrías por qué estar siendo discriminado por esta clase de situaciones. Hablemos del siguiente. Gerente de ventas foráneo. Un gerente de ventas foráneo tiene también salario. Aquí hablo específicamente, ¿no? Requisitos, buena presentación, que sea un hombre que sea casado en unión libre y con una edad. Aquí creo yo que la parte de discriminación es muy, muy grande, porque a ti te está quitando el derecho simplemente de aplicar por ser mujer rentada. Pero el problema es que también está hablando que tiene que ser un hombre con buena presentación, que sea casado y con un límite de edad, pues también muy corto, ¿no? Entonces, aquí todavía es más discriminativo y a nosotros pues, ya nos dejó fuera de entrada, ¿no? Entonces, es otro tipo de ofertas muy peligroso. La tercera, administrador de fraccionamiento. Aquí habla específicamente de una persona con licenciatura, indispensable actitud de servicio, amabilidad, buena presentación, proactividad y sentido común, ¿no? Aquí es igual discriminatorio. ¿Por qué? Porque te pide que seas de buena presentación. O sea, ¿qué significa que de buena presentación para ellos? No, obviamente son estándares los cuales cada empresa los pone. Entonces, muchas veces cuando alguien aplica las posiciones y la rechazan o no reciben nunca llamada del empleador, nunca entiende el por qué, ¿no? Dice, es que ¿qué hice mal o qué me faltó? Si yo cuento con la experiencia, yo tenía toda la actitud, yo tenía todas las ganas de trabajar, ¿no? Muchas veces simplemente es pues porque no cuentas con o en el físico que se espera, ¿no? Entonces, esta es otra actitud muy, muy discriminativa, la cual no está bien que nosotros normalicemos en la sociedad. Nosotros debemos normalizar que el trabajo no sea en base al físico, sino sea en base a nuestras aptitudes, a nuestros a nuestro trabajo, nuestra experiencia, lo que sabemos hacer y podemos hacer, ¿no? Aquí viene otro, aquí también en la parte de arriba, en esta parte, dice, una mujer de 25, 28 años, licenciatura en contabilidad, sin problemas de horario, soltera y sin hijos. ¿Qué te da a entender aquí? Aquí es clarísimo, probablemente si tú lo lees de primera entrada, nunca has trabajado, pues se te va a hacer fácil de aplicar, ¿no? Dices, bueno, no tengo hijos, no tengo problemas de horario. Pero es sumamente problemático esto, porque aquí la discriminación es grandísima. Aquí, tal cual te están diciendo, sin problemas de horario es, vas a trabajar más de 8 horas de entrada al día. O sea, no sabes si 10, 12, 15 horas al día. Soltera sin hijos, pues obviamente por lo mismo, ¿no? Para que no te estés quejando, estés pidiendo permisos, porque eso significa que te pueden llegar a despedir, ¿no? Hay empresas muy especiales en esta parte, ¿no? Que buscan mucho que las personas estén completamente a su disposición y no respetan la vida personal de cada uno de los empleados, que eso también está muy mal. Por eso lo que me gustaría platicarles aquí es, por favor, no normalicemos esta clase de empleos, no debe de ser aceptado. Debemos de poder luchar porque esta parte sea totalmente diferente y que las empresas puedan contratar sin ningún tipo de sesgos. Vamos a hablar en la siguiente. Aquí vienen otro tipo de ofertas laborales también en general. Aquí, bueno, disponibilidad de tiempo, igual vemos lo mismo. Vemos también aquí disponibilidad, a pesar de que te marcan hora, ¿no? De 9 a 6, bueno, que igual al final nos piden también la disponibilidad de hora. Es lo mismo, o sea, volvemos a ver lo mismo. Abres con tu trabajo, abres cualquier fuente de trabajo y vas a ver estas ofertas con mucha regularidad. Aquí hay otro también, igualmente te solicitan igual soltera, excelente presentación, cosas muy, muy discriminativas, ¿no? Aquí, como les digo, debes de ser muy abiertos si hay, ser claros, ¿no? Y en las ofertas laborales, el que están solicitando. Si aquí te están solicitando, pues, que tengas disponibilidad de horario, está bien, siempre y cuando cumplas tus 8 horas, ¿no? Y si te vas a trabajar estas 8 horas, bueno, pues, recibir el pago de tu salario de horas, ¿no? Extras, acorde a la ley federal del trabajo, ¿no? Como les dije, el problema es normalizar esta clase de situaciones. No debemos normalizarlos, debemos empezar a levantar la mano en esta parte para que las ofertas laborales no lleguen a ser excesivas, ¿no? La carga de trabajo llega a ser excesivo y a veces también el salario pues no va acorde con lo que se está solicitando. Vamos a hablar un poco del tema de acoso sexual. Existen los trabajos. Muchas veces pues no hay manera de poderlo denunciar. ¿Por qué? Porque muchas veces las mismas empresas lo van encubriendo, ¿no? Ay, no pasa nada, no te preocupes, no digas nada, yo hablo con él. En lugar de tener como un protocolo interno cada empresa, bueno, prefieren como hacerlo a un lado, ¿no? Entonces, aquí es muy, muy importante que siempre que ustedes no se sientan apoyadas en su centro de trabajo, vayan directamente y hagan una denuncia penal para poder avanzar en este proceso. Derechos Humanos también tiene el apoyo totalmente, si no hay apoyo de ninguno de los dos lados, para poder iniciar esta demanda, ¿no? Hay de diferentes tipos, ya sea de naturaleza sexual no deseado, son pues, simplemente contactos o situaciones en las que tú te sientes incómodo, ¿no? Sientes que está llegando a más allá el contacto. Una conducta verbal de naturaleza sexual, bueno, pues es cuando te empiezan a hacer insinuaciones, comentarios incómodos en los que no están pues, relacionados con tu fuente de trabajo. El comportamiento no verbal como tal, igual, cuando te están mostrando fotografías sugestivas o que te hacen sentir igualmente incómoda. Y los comportamientos también que te afectan a ti en tu dignidad. Todo esto son comportamientos que deben de ser directamente reportados. No deben de ser comportamientos aceptados ni deben de ser comportamientos por los cuales nos tenemos que quedar calladas. Por eso siguen existiendo. Entonces es importante que podamos detenerlos a tiempo. Como les dije, pueden ir directamente a, ya sea con su empleador y de base a eso, la respuesta que reciban, ya de ahí pueden ir directamente a la Procuraduría Federal de Defensa del Trabajo, a la Secretaría del Trabajo, al Seguro Social o directamente a Derechos Humanos. En cualquiera de estas instituciones deben de recibirles su denuncia y tomar toda la información para que se haga una investigación a fondo. Vamos a hablar de los estereotipos laborales. Los estereotipos laborales usualmente se generan por diversas situaciones. Les voy a mostrar un videito que yo vi hace poco hecho por Pixar, que me parece muy, muy interesante porque prácticamente resume todo lo que es un estereotipo laboral. Vamos a ver.
So, gym tonight? BRO Capital. Yeah, so you'll be up on the fourth floor with investments and
what? The tigers are coming. Yes. Está prácticamente rodeada de hombres.
I'm sure you'll fit right in.
Thanks. I still think it's unbelievable that I'm really here.
Llega esta chica que se llama Pearl, dice que está muy contenta de estar aquí.
I mean, unbelievable.
Ugh, I'm so excited. Yeah, I have a really good feeling about this.
Bueno, aquí él lo que hace es como contarle a todos, ¿no? Que llegó, que es una bola de lana, etcétera. Entonces, pues, recibe este mensaje. E inicia aquí el proceso de discriminación, ¿no?
Good morning. Hi there.
Did you see? They hired a Wally.
Gentlemen.
Bueno, aquí vemos que la chica empieza a sentirse incómoda.
With the porcupine, the pricks are on the outside.
So, why do spiders weave webs?
Cuenta un chiste, pues.
Crochet.
Is that like a sport or something?
Like with the needles and, you know?
Hey guys, staff meeting. As you can see, we've got a big fat failure on our hands. So, finance wants answers. Ideas?
Excuse me. Oh, guys, let's bring finance in and knit our strategies together.
What? Nah, you're being too soft. We gotta be aggressive.
Yeah, we gotta be aggressive.
Aquí le propone como una estrategia en la cual se deben de trabajar, y ellos dicen que no, que deben de ser pues agresivos, ¿no? Vemos claramente pues que no la dejan participar, la dejan a un lado.
Yeah, that's everybody. All right, first round's on Gronkowski.
El acoso laboral fue tanto que, bueno, ella llega al punto en que prácticamente decide rendirse, ¿no? Decir, bueno, pues no tengo una oportunidad aquí. Lo reconsidera, pero el problema es cómo lo reconsidera. Entonces, a ver.
She always sit there to recognize her.
And he says, I know the suit is expensive, baby, but at my apartment, it's 100% off.
Well, these results speak for themselves. But finance is still asking for.
I say we go for it, and if finance takes a kiss.
Somewhere. Let's go. Happy hours, Swifties. Is that everybody? No, hold up. Not everybody.
Hi, I'm Pearl. I'm Lacey.
What are they doing?
I was such a fright. Hey guys, this is Lacey. Welcome to BRO Capital. You'll be up on the fourth floor with investors.
It's still kind of unbelievable that I'm here.
I would say it's unbelievable.
Wow, I have a really good feeling about this.
Bueno, pues aquí vimos un poquito
que no solamente existe pues el acoso como tal sexual, ¿no? Sino también existe un acoso laboral en el cual simplemente por el hecho de ser mujer, bueno, pues muchas veces ya existen sesgos que impiden crear una buena relación desde un principio, ¿no? Aquí vimos como la bolita de lana le costó un poco adaptarse hasta que, bueno, prácticamente empezó a actuar como ellos para que pudiera ser aceptada, ¿no? En el momento que ya se da cuenta de la otra bolita de lana que también ingresa y se ve reflejada en ella, bueno, pues se da cuenta que efectivamente pues esa clase de situaciones se deben de romper, ¿no? Cuando uno rompe este tipo de actitudes y de estereotipos es cuando las relaciones empiezan a cambiar, ¿no? Al final vimos, bueno, que ya estaba lleno de bolitos de lana que estaban conviviendo pues con los ejecutivos y bueno, pues todo era como mucho más amigable, ¿no? La intención es que podamos trabajar de esta manera y entender por qué existen los sesgos, por qué hay ese rechazo de entrada que a uno no lo deja poder trabajar, ¿no? Vamos a platicar un poquito de esto. Vamos a ver, ¿qué función tienen los prejuicios? Bueno, los prejuicios en sí son ideas las cuales han estado generación tras generación en todos los seres humanos. Estos prejuicios prácticamente nacemos y los aprendemos, ¿no? Por ejemplo, en una familia, bueno, se les enseña que, no sé, los hombres siempre son los que tienen la razón, los hombres son los que se encargan de trabajar y la mujer no puede trabajar porque se dedica exclusivamente al hogar y se dedica exclusivamente a la comida y a los hijos, ¿no? Entonces, si en algún punto la mujer quisiera cambiar ese rol y poder también trabajar, a tener acceso pues a todas las prestaciones y también meter a sus hijos a la guardería, etcétera, empieza a haber un conflicto, ¿no? Un conflicto pues entre el hombre y un conflicto entre la mujer. ¿Por qué? Pues porque él fue el hombre educado con que la mujer tiene que estar en casa y ella, bueno, pues la mujer que quiere tener una oportunidad, que desea aprender y obviamente desarrollarse profesionalmente, porque pues eso es lo que también a las mujeres han luchado por muchos años al día de hoy. Empieza a haber un conflicto, ¿no? Entonces, no llega a entender el hombre el por qué ella quiere eso y la mujer no llega a entender el por qué el hombre piensa eso. Todo eso se remonta a los sesgos, a los prejuicios. ¿Por qué? Bueno, pues porque el papá de esta persona, el del chico, tenía la misma idea, la mamá siempre estuvo en su casa, no trabajó, no había necesidad. Entonces, es cuando él le dice, es que mi mamá y mi papá y así y así, ella, pero yo no lo entiendo. Entonces, se puede crear todo un conflicto simplemente por un prejuicio, ¿no? Por no cambiar. Por ejemplo, cuando entró la bolita de Lana Paul, se fijaron que empezó el prejuicio del chico del elevador, que decía, bueno, pues ella qué, ¿no? Pues es diferente, es una mujer, no es como nosotros, y les manda luego un mensaje a todos las personas que trabajaban ahí con él como para alertarles, ¿no? Entonces, unos empiezan a creer que es gracioso, otros empiezan a rechazarla, simplemente por un prejuicio de que porque era diferente, ¿no? Eso no significa que sea malo, simplemente es un prejuicio. Como les digo, los prejuicios simplemente son ideas las cuales hemos aprendido y hemos nacido prácticamente con ellas, y lamentablemente lo traemos. El problema es cuando no identificamos estos prejuicios. Hay que ser súper conscientes de todos los prejuicios que tenemos y detenerlos. Esto es desde nuestra mente, el poder decirle un stop, un basta, y que no nos nuble la mente. Por ejemplo, hablamos anteriormente de las ofertas laborales. En estas ofertas laborales, los prejuicios fueron muy claros. ¿Por qué? Pues porque buscaban a chicas guapas, chicas que tuvieran la disponibilidad de horario, etcétera, ¿no? Con cierta edad. Entonces, es un prejuicio en el que nada más creen que una persona soltera, por ejemplo, puede tener, puede trabajar sin ningún problema o puede tener como esta extensión de horarios para cumplir su trabajo. Que no es así. Hay personas que tienen hijos, que trabajan muy bien, y que eso no es ningún impedimento, ¿no? En realidad simplemente es abrir la mente, ¿no? Simplemente romper esos prejuicios y estereotipos y poder llegar más allá. Vamos a ver esta imagen. Esta imagen me gusta porque es muy significativa de los prejuicios que todos traemos internamente. Si yo les pregunto, ¿qué piensan en esta imagen? ¿Qué es lo primero que les llega a la mente cuando ven esto? Algunas personas me van a decir, bueno, pues es miedo, es terror, van a matar a alguien, están persiguiendo a alguien, se encontró una pistola tirada, ¿no? Alguien me puede decir, ah, se encontró una pistola tirada y está buscando de quién es. Es un asesino, está actuando en una película. Una imagen puede hacer simplemente que los pensamientos de muchas personas sean diversificados y totalmente diferentes, ¿no? No llegamos siempre al mismo pensamiento, independientemente que sea la misma imagen. Esos son los prejuicios. Lo que tú has aprendido, lo que tú traes, lo que tu familia te ha estado diciendo, es lo que tú vas a estar pudiendo pues interpretar en base a las situaciones, objetos o imágenes que te se estén presentando. Aquí hay otra imagen. Esta otra imagen me gusta también porque también es interesante ver cómo hay diferentes personas que no saben qué es esto o te interpretan de diferente manera. Me ha tocado en otras conferencias que me dicen, bueno, es una calavera, la muerte, una imagen tipo Picasso. Me ha dado muchísimos significados de esta imagen en las personas conforme al paso del tiempo. Y me llama la atención porque eso me da a entender que definitivamente todos los prejuicios son aprendidos, ¿no? Todos pensamos diferente en base a algo muy sencillo. Entonces, si se fijan, aquí ya pues, es una vaca, ¿no? Ya cuando uno la ve dibujada y todo, y regresamos la imagen, ya la visualizas, ya la ves claramente, y te das cuenta que qué es, ¿no? Pero inicialmente, pues te puede costar cierto trabajo, ¿no? Una calavera, etcétera, ¿no? La muerte, muchas cosas que me han dicho. Entonces, aquí es muy interesante ver cómo todos podemos pensar diferente. ¿no? Eso es lo que hace que de repente tengamos los prejuicios. Vamos a seguir hablando de los sesgos inconscientes. Como les platicaba, bueno, son ideas o juicios de personas, situaciones, etcétera, que están influenciadas directamente por la educación, formación, la familia y las experiencias que hemos tenido. Lamentablemente, esta es la primera y la más fuerte barrera a la inclusión que existe. ¿Por qué? Porque está ligada directamente a nuestro cerebro, no la controlamos de inicio. Son simplemente fugaz, aparece y es muy difícil controlarla, es muy difícil detenerla. Lamentablemente, como les decía, bueno, todos los seres humanos tenemos estos sesgos, ¿no? Todos estamos expuestos a medios de comunicación, nos vas manejando, vas de repente un espectacular, escuchas el radio, ves la televisión, redes sociales, la información de tu familia, toda esta información, esta carga grandísima, hace que nuestra mente llegue y obviamente empecemos a tener esos sesgos, ¿no? Les voy a poner un ejemplo de una situación que yo creo que todos conocen recientemente que sucedió, de una actriz de Televisa, ¿no? Por ejemplo, usualmente estamos acostumbrados a que en las telenovelas, las películas, etcétera, la mayoría de las actrices, si no es que pues, una gran mayoría, son blancas, son rubias, de ojos de color, etcétera, y la tendencia no es que sean morenas o de piel oscura, ya negras, o que sean, que lleguen a ser también asiáticas, etcétera, o de otro tipo de cultura, ¿no? Siempre son las mismas. Entonces, hace poco, aquí en México hubo todo un dilema, porque hubo una telenovela que, bueno, la televisora decía, bueno, es que no tiene éxito nuestra telenovela, porque la gente cree que la actriz es fea, ¿no? Pues porque era una actriz que no era la típica rubia de ojos de color que estaba la gente acostumbrada. Era una actriz que era pues muy guapa, morena, de unos ojos grandes, y también decían ellos, bueno, pues es que también les incomoda el lunar que tiene. O sea, ideas que simplemente no están bien, más porque estamos en México, más porque nuestra cultura es muy, muy diversa. Tenemos prácticamente, pues desde el norte hasta el sur de México, todo tipo de personas, culturas, idiomas también, ¿no? Digo, no hablando específicamente del área de Yucatán y toda la área sur, bueno, pues también hay personas que tienen ya en su mismo día a día, pues utilizan algunas palabras mayas o de algún otro tipo de lenguas, las cuales pues es su día a día, ¿no? Entonces, cuando no estamos como acostumbrados a verlo en la tele, es cuando empieza a causar un conflicto. Pero es un conflicto infundado, porque al final de cuentas la mayoría de personas, pues, contamos con la piel morena, ¿no? Tal cual como es en México, es totalmente normal. Pero lamentablemente, como vemos en redes sociales, que las guapas son las de ojos claros, las rubias, las güeras, o vemos también que son las que ganan más, o las que mejores tienen, o las supermodelos, que son como con este perfil específico, es cuando nos empieza a causar un conflicto, ¿no? Que decimos, no, yo estoy acostumbrada a ver esto, 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 y cuando me lo cambian, es cuando ya no lo acepto mentalmente. ¿Cómo sucede esto? Lo primero que sucede cuando inician los sesgos inconscientes es, por ejemplo, llega una persona que nunca habías visto, se presenta contigo y le empiezas a clasificar totalmente, no es voluntario, es una clasificación que inicia de repente. Tú la empiezas a clasificar, a ver, es una mujer, es morena, es alta, chaparra, delgada, con ojos grandes, pequeños, etc. O sea, tu mente empieza a clasificar a las personas sin ni siquiera darte cuenta inicialmente, pues, que es una persona, todos somos diferentes y eso no tiene por qué ser una clasificación. A veces yo creo que a todos les ha pasado que conocen a alguien y ya te cae mal ese alguien simplemente porque lo viste, ¿no? Ay, esa persona me cae mal y tiene cara de X y cuando esa persona no la conoces, no te has dado el tiempo de hablar con ella, de conocer sus hobbies, quizás esa persona sea más afín a ti de lo que tú puedes imaginarte, ¿no? Les gusta lo mismo, tengan buena comunicación, pueden llegar a tener una gran amistad, pero simplemente porque esa persona no tiene lo que tú quieres o no es como tú la esperas, ya la estás clasificando mal, ¿no? Entonces, ese es un problema grandísimo que debemos empezar a parar, ¿no? Aquí tenemos otras diferentes maneras de clasificar a las personas. No solamente son si son guapas o feas, ¿no? Hay muchísimas. Clasificamos a las personas por religión, por su peso, si tienen discapacidad, su tipo de orientación sexual, su acento, ¿no? Muchas veces, ay, es que yo vivo en Jalisco, pero me desespera cómo hablan las personas de DF, ¿no? He escuchado comentarios así que la verdad, tú dices, bueno, pues obviamente vives en diversas zonas de México, no va a ser el mismo tipo de manera de hablar, ¿no? Como aquí dice que hablamos cantadito, ¿no? Entonces, obviamente somos diferentes las personas y eso no tiene que ser un problema. El tono de piel, el nombre, ¿no? ¿Cuántas veces también no les ha tocado que hay nombres de personas que también las personas nada más, porque se llaman diferente o tienen un nombre que no es común, ya empiezan a tirarle, pues, estos comentarios malintencionados? La apariencia, nacionalidad, la situación económica. Hay muchas maneras de poder clasificar, no solamente es si cumples mis estándares o no. Entonces, hay que tener mucho cuidado con esto, ¿no? Cuando nos llega este pensamiento, que conozcamos una nueva persona o estemos en una situación, poder detenerlo, decir, a ver, ¿por qué me está llegando este pensamiento? Si ni siquiera hablaba con esta persona, si ni siquiera me he dado el tiempo de platicar, de conocerla, de poder evitar juzgarla, ¿no? Porque la estás juzgando y ni siquiera has hablado ni una palabra, ¿no? Ni pío han dicho. Entonces, tener mucho cuidado con esta situación. Nosotros como mujeres debemos de romper estas barreras y poder hacer que las personas pues seamos igual, ¿no? La igualdad de género, tratar de evitar que las personas tengan sesgo simplemente porque somos mujeres y creen que no podemos hacer lo mismo o que estamos debajo o que no podemos ganar la misma cantidad de dinero o que no tenemos la misma capacidad, etcétera, ¿no? Al contrario, todos podemos pues hacer de todo, simplemente hay que romper estas ideas, ¿no? Bueno, aquí como les platicaba, el problema no es los sesgos como tal, ¿no? Simplemente es algo que no controlamos, algo que aparece, pero pues hay que empezar a romper esto, para no empezar a crearnos estos conceptos, ¿no? Como les decía, bueno, no, todos somos diferentes, hay que evitar estos conceptos negativos, hay que tratar de que las personas acepten, ¿no? Como somos, sin generar ningún problema. Algo que yo hago mucho en mis procesos de reclutamiento es, yo les pido mucho sus currículums, no me gusta pedirlos con fotos. ¿Por qué? Porque no es necesario, ¿no? Pues a mí me interesa saber la capacidad de las personas, su experiencia, qué pueden aportar, o sea, qué tanto traen ganas de poder aprender, saber las cosas o decirme, ¿no? Hay mucha gente que tiene esta hambre, ¿no? De crecer, de saber, de preguntar. Eso es lo que más me importa, pero lamentablemente algunos lugares cuando envían currículums, rechazan esos currículums simplemente porque no tienen foto, ¿no? Pero pues al enviar foto empieza a crear también así esos sesgos de, ay, esta persona no, pues no es, o él no es hombre, ¿no? Yo quiero un ingeniero que esté rolando turnos en mi fábrica, pero es una mujer. Yo no quiero una mujer porque me va a estar pidiendo permisos, no va a poder cumplir con su horario, se va a estar quejando. Entonces, hay que romper con estos sesgos, porque al igual que los hombres, las mujeres también pueden cumplir perfectamente con este tipo de roles sin ningún problema. Entonces, como les decía, hay que ser totalmente conscientes de nuestros prejuicios y tener cuidados con ellos. No dejar que estos prejuicios nos hagan tomar decisiones equivocadas. Por ejemplo, como les decía, en un proceso de reclutamiento, tú estás trabajando con un gerente o un director para una posición y ellos, al ver el currículum, te dicen, bueno, sí, esta mujer tiene 10 años de experiencia, pero pues dice que tiene dos hijos, que está casada. Eso significa que pues va a estar saliéndose cada rato, ¿no? O no va a poder cumplir sus obligaciones por los niños, etcétera. Sino, lo que yo hago es muy de, a ver, no, o sea, eso no va a pasar. Simplemente sigue aplicando porque le interesa la posición, porque está toda la disposición. Y sus hijos no van a ser ningún inconveniente. Al contrario, van a ser un motor que le dé para que esa persona sea más comprometida, tenga más ganas de saber, de quedarse. Y usualmente lo que me ha sucedido es que esa clase de personas son más, se quedan más en las empresas por más tiempo. ¿Por qué? Pues porque al agradecer esa parte de poderles dar el trabajo, la oportunidad de que esas personas se desarrollen y estén felices en su trabajo, pues evidentemente hacen que no se quieran ir, están contentos, ¿no? La oportunidad es lo que ellos más valoran y el trabajo, el que ellos puedan tener estas ganas, ¿no? Entonces, evitemos esta clase de sesgos. Todas las mujeres tenemos como derecho a ser tratadas de igual manera que un hombre, ganar exactamente el mismo salario que un hombre, recibir las mismas prestaciones que un hombre. ¿Por qué? Porque también me he topado con muchas ofertas laborales que he visto que te ofrecen el salario mínimo, no te ofrecen las prestaciones como deben de ser, las cuales pueden ser un problema para ti, ¿no? ¿Por qué? Pues porque en una maternidad pues no vas a recibir el salario que te corresponde ni vas a poder tomar quizá el descanso que necesitas para poder estar con tu bebé. Entonces, yo les digo a todas, por favor, revisen muy bien las ofertas laborales, qué viene, qué cumplen, y si no es una oferta laboral en la que ustedes se sientan cómodas, ya sea por las prestaciones, por cómo te tratan, por el exceso de tiempo que te están exigiendo. Hay trabajos que te exigen más de 12 horas al día, que pues, son muy, muy extenuantes. No los tomen, ¿no? Hay que tratar de cambiar, pues, a la sociedad en México, tratar de presionar para que las personas no tengan estos sesgos, estas ideas de que las mujeres no pueden, son menos, sino al contrario, ¿no? Que podamos trabajar en conjunto cómodamente, que podamos estar teniendo responsabilidades igual que otro. Ya decía Shannon, bueno, lamentablemente pues posiciones directivas o de CEO son unas posiciones muy raras que se llegan a ofrecer a las mujeres, usualmente son directamente hacia los hombres, ¿no? Ni siquiera se piensa en una mujer muchas veces, no digo que sea siempre, pero sí muchas veces. Entonces, tratemos de romper como todas estas prejuicios que existen y exigir nuestros derechos, porque como tal, como les platicaba, tenemos derecho a la salud, tenemos derecho al trabajo digno, tenemos derecho a la maternidad, tenemos derecho pues simplemente a estar en un lugar seguro, ¿no? Entonces, es lo más importante que yo quisiera decirles. Tengo trabajando en recursos humanos más de 8 años, entonces me he topado pues con estos cambios. He tratado lo más posible de trabajar rompiendo esta clase de sesgos en todo tipo de empresas en las que he estado, con mi equipo. Y bueno, pues es un trabajo, ¿no? De mucho tiempo, ¿no? No nada más va a ser un trabajo que sea nada más de unos días, ¿no? Simplemente es un trabajo que tenemos que cumplir todos para poder hacer valer pues nuestros derechos. Bueno, pues les agradezco mucho su tiempo, espero que les haya gustado la presentación, que les haya gustado lo que platicamos y que de verdad trabajen en los sesgos. Es muy importante que trabajemos en romper estos prejuicios para poder lograr una sociedad mucho más amigable, ¿no? Rompiendo todas estas ideas y cosas que traemos de atrás que no nos sirven de nada más que simplemente para perdernos la oportunidad de conocer gente grandiosa, ¿no? Entonces, pues, muchas gracias y si alguien tiene preguntas, con mucho gusto se las puedo responder. ¿Nadie tiene preguntas?
Chicos, ¿alguna pregunta?
No, no hay problema. De todos modos, con mucho gusto les puedo compartir mi correo electrónico con la licenciada Elizabeth y ella con mucho gusto puede hacérselo llegar para cualquier duda o comentario que tengan, o simplemente si quieren saber un poco más de los sesgos inconscientes, puedo pasarles un link, el cual es muy interesante porque uno piensa que no tiene sesgos, pero cuando haces este cuestionario te das cuenta todos los sesgos que tienes y lo peligroso que pueden llegar a ser, ¿no? Pues yo les paso de todos modos el link a la licenciada, para todos los que estén interesados en hacerlo, de verdad, háganlo, les va a ayudar bastante.
Muchas gracias por el apoyo. Siempre hemos tenido el apoyo de Metoba en todos los eventos. Y pues espero, este es de los primeros que hacemos en este año, de los muchos que vamos a hacer este año, porque traemos varias propuestas, varios programas de empleabilidad, de maratón, que ya se aproxima también, el maratón de oportunidades laborales. Ustedes, Miriam, muchísimas gracias. Estamos a nombre del CUSEI, estamos agradecidos por el gran apoyo que hemos tenido, que llevamos trabajando 2 años.
2 años.
2 años trabajando y hemos tenido muchísima participación por parte de Metoba. Es una colaboración CUSEI-Metoba que hemos tenido y que, pues, vaya, es muy grande, es todas las charlas que nos han estado dando, es nada más le decimos, Miriam, tenemos esto, va Elizabeth, vamos con todo. Y pues ahorita con los temas de la mujer, en la semana de en conmemoración a la mujer, a la celebración de la mujer, pues Metova va a estar presente. Esta es la segunda conferencia, Derechos Laborales de la Mujer, pero tenemos todavía otra participación por parte de Metova, es el jueves, si mal no recuerdo. Sí. Ah, ok, perfectísimo. Y pues el viernes tenemos por ahí también preguntas, algún tipo de un panel, en el cual pueden también los chicos acercarse, preguntar de todas las conferencias que se han dado. Va a estar también otra empresa con nosotros, otra empresa invitada. No se pierdan las conferencias que vamos a tener a lo largo de esta semana. Y pues agradezco muchísimo el apoyo. Es muy importante que las chicas, los chicos también, todos estén sensibilizados con estos temas, que no se tomen o no se queden nada más en un día, sino que sean no una semana, sino sean todo el año, todos los años, que empecemos a sensibilizar. Y pues sí, o sea, tener en cuenta y conocer de los derechos laborales, nos los habías dado el año pasado, pero también, en especial, derechos laborales de la mujer, ¿verdad? Sí. Que el hecho de ser mujer, el hecho de usar tenis, el hecho de usar botas, el hecho de usar tacones, el hecho de tener uno, dos hijos, o el hecho de no tener hijos, no nos imposibilita a lo que viene siendo un trabajo, una posición, y subir en esa posición también, ¿verdad? Subir en un trabajo.
Totalmente. Sí. Pues muchas gracias, gracias por la invitación, Elizabeth, gracias también al CUSEI y a la Universidad de Guadalajara. Yo con mucho gusto, siempre que me dicen, bueno, estaremos apoyando y les voy a mandar unos regalitos para las asistentes y todas las personas que estuvieron aquí con nosotros. Son algunas gorras, botellas de agua, y para café también, que me todas a los estudiantes con mucho gusto.
Ok, pues muchísimas gracias a nombre del CUSEI, a nombre de la maestra Eliana, coordinadora de extensión, y a nombre de la doctora Ruth Padilla, que es nuestra rectora de centro, la rectora de centro, mujer. Les damos muchísimas, muchísimas gracias a ustedes por la participación y el gran apoyo que han tenido hacia nosotros.
Muchas gracias, gracias a todos.
Gracias y nos vemos el jueves. ¿Sale?